Here's an equation derived from perturbation theory for estimating chemical reactivity. It's especially good for estimating differential reactivity, that is, for making a comparison between two similar reaction pathways and deciding which one is more favorable. No doubt this equation looks pretty daunting, but buried in it is the FMO conclusion that we reached on the previous slide. So how is it that the FMO prediction emerges from this equation? First of all, what is it that's meant by this delta E? Well, since we're dealing with a perturbation theory, it means the change in energy that takes place at a very early part of the reaction pathway when the orbitals from two reactants begin to interact with one another. There are three main terms to this equation, and if there's anything that jumps out at you, it's the number of sigma terms, or summation terms, that appear in this equation. Basically, what this equation is that we're going to add, which is what the sigma term means, a whole bunch of terms together in order to estimate how that energy changes. And those additions that these sigma terms represent are all of the possible orbital interactions that could arise as those two reactants approach one another. The term that's shown in blue is a term that we're going to end up ignoring, because basically it's a repulsive term that describes the occupied-occupied orbital interactions, those filled-filled interactions that we said were going to be destabilizing. In fact, it's actually these terms that give rise to a large portion of the activation energy for a molecule, for a pair of molecules as they begin to react. But this first term, this repulsive term, is almost the same for all reaction pathways that are going to be compared. And so usually we can simply ignore this term because there isn't much differential associated with this first term for the different reaction pathways. The second term involves charges, and so it's going to be especially important when we're dealing with polar molecules or molecules that bear charge. It's the third term that I want to focus our attention on, because in this third term, this is where the FMO conclusion that we reached on the previous slide emerges from. Let's begin with this innermost part of the third term and work our way out. E sub r represents the energy of molecular orbital r on one reactant, and E sub s is the energy of molecular orbital s on a second reactant. That this difference in energy appears in the denominator has a lot of significance. As the energy gap between these two interacting molecular orbitals grow, this term is going to become smaller and smaller. This is a term that's being added together with many other terms, and so if the energy gap is large, that addition can just simply be ignored. That's why the FMO theory works, because it's the term where this energy difference is the smallest, and it's the term that's going to contribute most to the additivity, which ultimately relates to the overall delta E. The numerator is the product of three terms, and here a picture might help. Let's consider pi orbitals of two ethylene molecules interacting. On one molecule, let's take the pi star, the LUMO, and have that interact with pi, the HOMO, of the second molecule. We'll call the first orbital R and the second one S, and each of these have LCAO coefficients, A and B. The numerator considers all of the combination of lobes interacting. Each line here represents one term, and each of the terms has a beta associated with it. The beta describes how strong the interaction is, and beta, for example, is going to be small if the interacting lobes are separated far apart in space. And finally, working our way outward with this third term, we need to figure out what all of these summations represent. Once again, a picture is going to help us to understand those summation terms. Consider a pair of reactants, A and B, and all the molecular orbital levels that are associated with those two molecules. Some of these levels are going to be filled with electrons, and others are going to be empty. And what we need to consider and what those summation terms are all of the possible filled empty interactions. We need to consider that for all of the filled levels on A interacting with all the empty levels on B, and then we need to turn that around and consider all of the filled levels on B interacting with the empty levels on A. At the end, we look for the smallest homolumo gap, because that's going to be the case where the energy between R and S are the smallest, and that's going to be the most important term in that equation. That's the FMO result.